Hey guys, this is Adam Chomsky, and I'm here to give you a tutorial on shooting hyperlapses. Now, I've seen some tutorials on YouTube about how to shoot hyperlapses, and they all seem a little more complicated and time-consuming than the way I do it, so I wanted to just give you a quick tutorial and show you the way I shoot hyperlapses. For one thing, I rarely use a tripod. Almost all of my hyperlapses are shot handheld, and I don't usually use an intervalometer either. I just manually trigger the camera with the shutter button each time. I started out shooting hyperlapses with a tripod, but I realized it wasn't really helping me align the images much. Every time I moved the tripod, I had to realign the camera anyway to keep the focusing dot on top of my subject, and I kind of realized, what's the point of this tripod? It's not really helping me much. So I started shooting them handheld, and I found that the results were just as good, and it was a lot easier to do. One caveat, if you're going to be shooting like at night, or you want to do a long exposure to get a motion blur look, you're going to need a tripod just to prevent motion blur due to camera shake. But the tripod, in my experience, doesn't really help me much in aligning the hyperlapse. It's really just to prevent motion blur. The easiest way to shoot a hyperlapse is just pick a focus point in your viewfinder and try to keep it directly on top of some subject, some part of your subject. So in this example, there's like a white star on the front of this building. They got some Christmas decorations up. And maybe my bottom center focus point, if I just keep that one in each photo, I try to keep that right on top of this bottom center focus point. That should help me align my images. Shoot a little wider angle than what you want your final result to look like. You'll have to do some cropping when you stabilize your hyperlapse, especially from the top and bottom if you're creating a 16:9 final result. Most cameras shoot in a 3:2 ratio, so they're a lot taller than a normal video. Very wide angle lenses can be difficult to use because of the lens distortion. So in this example, you can see that the building looks kind of jello-y and warpy. This is what warp stabilizer did by default. I was able to manually stabilize and it looks a lot more solid. However, you can still see the building in the top left corner as all wobbly and jello-y. It just kind of moved the warping over there. I shot this with a fisheye lens, and this warping is due to the fact that the fisheye has extreme distortion, and the distortion is different from image to image because I didn't align the camera perfectly for each shot. So now it's hard to get rid of that wobbling. To trigger your shots, you can use an intervalometer like this one, which I used for my Canon T2i. They're pretty cheap. I think this was like 30 bucks or something. Or you can use something like a firmware hack on a Canon T2i or other Canon cameras, DSLRs. There's a magic lantern firmware hack. If your camera doesn't already have an intervalometer built in, you can go in and change the settings of your intervalometer on your camera. But the easiest thing for me, since I already have the camera in my hands, I'm already aiming it, is I just push the button each time. So one caveat with that is if you have clouds or something constantly moving in the background, and your intervals between shots are erratic, and especially if you have an extra long gap between a couple of your shots, you might end up with the clouds jumping in between frames. So I try to just keep the intervals somewhat consistent. It doesn't have to be super precise, but you keep them somewhat consistent and it'll come out good.
If you watch the clouds in this example, you can see them where they jump. There was a time when some people were standing in the way where I needed to walk, so I had to wait a minute for them to move. It might have been 30 seconds or something, but it was enough that you can see a jump in the clouds during my final result. So that's one danger if you don't use an intervalometer. You should try to keep the shots somewhat equal.
So I've heard of people making chalk marks on the ground to measure out their intervals, and I think that's more precise than I've ever been. And I think it works out pretty well even if you don't have to have that kind of precision. So if there's bricks or blocks on the ground, I'll try to move one brick at a time or two bricks at a time, or use those to kind of help guide me along. But if there's no bricks, like in this case we have just grass, depending on how fast I want to move, I could just move like, you know, kind of like one small step at a time, kind of move sideways like that, or just kind of like try to keep one foot, you know, the heel of one foot equal to the toe of the other foot, something like that. Or I might just move two steps at a time, or three steps, or 10 steps. It just depends on how fast I want to go in my hyperlapse. And I found that just using a rough estimation like that is usually good enough.
In this hyperlapse of the National Mall, I moved 10 steps between each shot. I could have even moved more because I kind of like this one sped up even faster.
I usually like to just walk through my path ahead of time. And one thing I do is just count the number of steps it takes me to get from one end to the other. And that way I know about how many shots I can get off if I step one step at a time, or if I do two steps at a time, or half a step. So that'll prevent me from accidentally shooting a hyperlapse that's only, you know, 30 frames long or something like that.
I process my hyperlapses at 24 frames per second. Since it's really easy to do math with multiples of 25, I just guesstimate the length of my hyperlapse by multiplying or dividing by 25. So if it takes me 100 steps to walk through my path, I know I'll take 100 photos if I move one step between shots, and that'll give me a 4-second hyperlapse. If it takes me 400 steps and I take one step between each shot, I'll get 400 photos. That's a 16-second hyperlapse. So if I don't want it to be that long, I can just say, well, I'll walk 2 steps or 4 steps between shots and cut down the length. Number of photos divided by 25 is approximately the length of my hyperlapse in seconds.
Another thing I like to do is stop every once in a while, kind of just frame it up and just see how the shot is looking. Sometimes the point that I choose to keep my focusing dot on top of, I find that once I get to the middle or to the end of the hyperlapse that the framing doesn't really look very good if I'm on that point, so I might want to reconsider which point I'm going to choose.
In this example, I decided to keep the top right focusing point on the front corner of this structure in the foreground. But as I got further and further along in my hyperlapse, I realized that I was mostly just kind of pointing at the sky, and it didn't really make sense to continue going, so I just kind of cut it off and ended up being shorter than I wanted it. If your path is a little haphazard instead of being on a straight line or a smooth arc, that will be apparent in your final result. Especially if you're moving straight toward your subject, it can be really obvious if you wobble a little bit left and right, especially if there are things closer in the foreground that really are going to move relative to the background. In this hyperlapse, I was moving down this long, narrow hallway, and I kind of scooted a little bit to the left and right as I was going down the hall. You can see that the perspective changes as I'm moving through the hyperlapse, and it creates these jitters that are really hard to get rid of. I never really figured out a way to get rid of those. So making your path as smooth as you can is important, especially if there are things in the foreground, and especially if you're moving straight toward your subject.
As far as camera settings, I like to shoot in camera raw so that I can make raw adjustments later. It just gives you a little bit of extra flexibility to make adjustments to the color and saturation and such to make your images really pop. I just try to keep the shutter speed high enough to make sure that I don't get motion blur from camera shake. You know, the formula is 2 times the focal length. Like if you're shooting with a 24 millimeter lens, 1/48th or faster is typical. So just try to make sure it's, you know, I try to make sure mine is like at least 1/100th of a second, and to reduce the camera blur. Manual white balance is helpful to prevent color shifts during your shot, and manual exposure can be helpful, but actually on this shot and a lot of my shots, I just use auto exposure because as I was shooting this, it got darker and darker, and the auto exposure just automatically adjusts for that. You could end up with some flickering in your final image if you use auto exposure, and there's some software tools to help you get rid of that. But the alternative is if you have a lot of lighting changes during your time lapse, your images might end up way too bright or way too dark at the end.
Here's a cool tip. Try shooting hyperlapses from a boat. It's really kind of easy because the boat takes care of the movement for you. All you have to do is hold the camera and just try to keep one of your focus points pointed at your subject, put it on an intervalometer, and have the camera automatically take photos every 1 to 3 seconds. I usually use about 2-second interval when I'm shooting from a boat. All these hyperlapses were shot from a boat.